Patterns are all around us. And as humans, we sometimes build these patterns into what we create. The feathers of a peacock can turn into a beautiful painting. The spiraling pattern in a sunflower can turn into a piece of architecture. And the spiraling shell can be a work of art. Why is the spiraling pattern of a piece of art so similar to the clouds of a hurricane? Why are the clouds of a hurricane so similar to the arms of a galaxy? Hi, I'm Claire, and welcome to my TED Talk. I have always been fascinated by patterns in nature. And even I integrate some of these patterns into my own artworks, such as this piece, where I collage some of my radial designs onto a canvas with color. My curiosity behind the art and the science of patterns of forms led me to studying this for my senior thesis. I wanted to look at both the mathematical exploration of why these patterns occur so often and go into the more artistic side to why we might be visually drawn to these patterns. With this in mind, my research question became, how can reoccurring patterns and forms of nature be explained mathematically? And why are humans visually drawn to recreating these patterns? I soon realized there are countless patterns in our universe and it's difficult to universally explain them all. So I decided to focus my research on the Fibonacci sequence and its role in our natural environment. The Fibonacci sequence was first introduced by Leonardo of Pisa, also known as Fibonacci, an Italian mathematician. He used this sequence in solving a problem involving the population growth of rabbits. This particular pattern is found surprisingly often in nature, and mathematicians, artists, and scientists have been fascinated by it for centuries. So as you can see, the preceding number in the sequence is found by the sum of the previous two. So I'm going to have you guys do some simple math. You can. So 0 plus 1 is?
1.
1 plus 1 is?
2.
1 plus 2 is?
3.
2 plus 3 is?
5.
And so on. To make this pattern into a spiral and a rectangle, we start with a 1 by 1 box, add another 1 by 1 box next to that, 2 by 2 box below that, 3 by 3 box, mimicking the pattern above, a 5x5 box, and an 8x8 box. And this pattern can continue on infinitely. By taking the dimensions of this rectangle we've created, we can obtain a ratio. So to do that, we need two side lengths, one which is 8, and the other is 8 and 5, which makes 13. And by dividing them, we can get a ratio of about 1.6. This is commonly referred to as the golden ratio. And a rectangle with holding these proportions can be referred to as a golden rectangle. Through this table, we can see that as the dimensions of a few golden rectangles increase, the decimal place on their ratios becomes a more and more precise version of the actual golden ratio. This exact number can also be referred to as phi, the irrational number of phi. It is important to see the connection the golden ratio has to the Fibonacci sequence and how we can get one from the other. A few more forms of the golden ratio can be found in the golden pentagon, the golden angle, which I'll use later, so try to remember that if you can. And the golden triangle. The term golden comes from the ancient theory that these specific proportions hold a profound beauty to the human eye. And this is why it is present in so many human creations. Within the aesthetic side of my research, I found that the golden ratio can be found throughout various forms of art, such as Greek architecture, some paintings such as the Great Wave. Although there are many critics that argue this is sometimes accurate and imprecise, I have found it can be true in some cases. The golden ratio has also manifested itself within the human body through our figure proportions, places such as our hands and our ears. It is argued whether or not artists intended to use this specific ratio in their work, or if it appeared naturally because it's already found within the human body itself. The true aesthetic value of the golden ratio is still debated today. Many past experiments are inconclusive because of the difficulty in defining aesthetics. Aesthetics has to do with beauty, and perceptions of beauty vary between individuals. One modern theory behind the aesthetic value of the golden ratio has to do with the design and shape of the human eye. So because of this specific organ's design, it makes it so that we can scan something vertically, we can scan something horizontally faster than we can vertically. If someone's given a set amount of time to scan an object, their field of vision often results in a shape which has proportions similar to the golden ratio. This theory argues that shapes and forms that withhold this ratio are not necessarily prettier, they're just easier for us to visually perceive. And this can be connected to why we may find them aesthetically pleasing, because they're already in tune with how we see the world. Another theory behind the aesthetic value of the golden ratio has to do with how fast we can visually process complex Fibonacci patterns. In an experiment, test subjects were asked to perform a series of tests which tested the speed and the functionality of their visual processing. So, in one example, subjects were presented with an image such as this, and one of the black squares would quickly turn, flash to white, and then turn back. How fast the test subject could point out exactly which place that happened determined the speed of which they could visually process that. This experiment overall concluded that complex Fibonacci patterns slowed visual processing, and this can be considered as causing an aesthetic response. Although more research is still needed to prove both of these theories, combining the findings creates a new argument. Simple shapes and forms withholding the golden ratio proportions are easier for us to visually process, but as the degree of complexity increases, these patterns slow visual processing. From the aesthetic side to my research, I found that humans may be drawn to Fibonacci golden ratio patterns because they can cause sense of aesthetic by affecting our brain's ability to process information. What humans create may or may not be in coherence to this. However, countless studies prove that it is evident the Fibonacci sequence does appear in nature and can be found throughout various forms of plants, animals, trees, and shells. In my main source, the book Design in Nature, it's explained how systems in nature often work towards becoming more and more efficient, meaning using the least amount of energy to perform a certain task. Over time, a system becomes more efficient because evolution favors efficient structures. The Fibonacci sequence is a design used within these specific structures to ensure efficiency. For example, the branches around a tree trunk can sometimes be in a Fibonacci spiral because this specific design helps trees move water from the ground to the air efficiently. Another example can be found in the seeds of a sunflower, where the Fibonacci sequence is used to embed the most amount of developing plant structures using the least amount of space. In my research, I found that a growth hormone called auxin guides plants to grow in this specific way. This pattern is often exhibited at the peak of a system's functionality. And although it's found throughout many facets of nature, it can also be created artificially because it has self-assembling characteristics. In an experiment, when drops of magnetized liquid were put into a dish of oil, each drop repelled the previous at about a 137-degree angle. This is also known as the golden angle, if you remember from before. And as more and more drops were added, this eventually turned into a Fibonacci spiral. So as you can see here, that's kind of what happens in this experiment. This experiment proved that Fibonacci patterns could be created artificially, which models how they behave in nature. The self-assembling characteristics of this pattern can be useful in the field of stress engineering. These patterns appear because they minimize the total energy strain on a surface and are efficient. In one of the studies I looked at, a fabrication technique was found which produced organized structures across a large area without high precision patterning equipment. This means that structures can be created using these self-assembling properties to create structures without the need for complex mechanisms that use a lot of energy and resources. However, this is relatively new technology, so I don't have any specific examples of how this applies to our everyday lives. But the future implications of this are still promising. In this research, I haven't even been able to cover all of the things the Fibonacci sequence accounts for within our natural world. It's difficult to know exactly how many plants exhibit this pattern because it can be found in so many different shapes and forms. It's important to note that this is not the only pattern within our natural environment. There are many more patterns which are unaccounted for through this sequence. This sequence does not hold the restricted key to beauty. There are many more beautiful things than our world. This is only one piece of the puzzle we are building to better understand the world in which we live. Humans as a whole are working towards becoming more and more efficient. And what we create may be in coherence with the Fibonacci sequence. I concluded that the Fibonacci sequence does exist in our natural world, and some patterns can be explained through this phenomenon. Humans are overall drawn to these patterns because they can cause an aesthetic reaction in our brain, can cause an aesthetic reaction by affecting our brain's functionality and speed. The connection seen between designs in nature, designs in ourselves, and the designs of our own creation suggests how truly connected we are to the world in which we live. What is learned from designs in nature should be implemented into our own human creations, especially when it concerns using self-assembling technology, as done in the field of stress engineering. I'm not sure exactly how future research of this will lead to the development of our technology. However, I believe that from my research, future studies on this could be promising and could truly be applied to our everyday lives. Our knowledge of the Fibonacci sequence should be used as a tool and a base for further exploration, not as a limitation. I want you guys to try to imagine a world without pattern. Would you be able to recognize your surroundings? Would you even be able to recognize yourself? Thankfully, this is not the case. Now try to imagine the countless patterns and sequences we have yet to discover, and what mysteries they may unveil about ourselves and the world in which we live. Thank you.